So good evening everyone. Today we will see about some tumors of the middle ear and inner ear and hearing rehabilitation. So starting with glomus tumor. Glomus tumor is a benign tumor of the middle ear, okay? So the word glomus means it arises from it is a tumor of paraganglionic cells, okay? Tumor of paraganglionic cells. So that is, it is also called as paraganglioma. So paraganglioma means it is a tumor which arises from nerves, okay? So from its origin is from neural crest cells, from which it descends down. So glomus is present in many sites, not only in ear, but to the ear per se. Nerves are more common or more abundant in two sites. Okay, I hope you remember the anatomy, which it is promontory. In promontory, there is number of nerves or the plexus of nerves called a tympanic plexus. So when it arises from this plexus, it is called as glomus tympanicum. And next is in the floor. In the floor, there is a jugular bulb, right? And near the jugular bulb, there is also 9, 10 and 11 cranial nerves. So from if it arises from this part, it is called as glomus jugulare. Okay, so this glomus tympanicum, this is the most common benign tumor of the middle ear. So in within the glomus, this glomus tympanicum is the most common benign tumor of middle ear. Okay. So you could see here, this is the floor of the middle ear, where you could see this is the sigmoid sinus. Sigmoid continuing as jugular bulb here, and this is the internal carotid artery. Here you could see the 9, 10 and 11th cranial nerves. So from this cranial nerves of the tumor arises, it is called a glomus jugulare, okay? Glomus jugulare. So this glomus tumor is a locally invasive tumor. It is not malignant. It is benign but locally invasive, okay? And it is very slow growing. Very slow growing, and it is encapsulated. So this glomus tumor in other places is not only present in ear, okay? If it is, I hope you heard about pheochromocytoma. It is also a paraganglioma. But this pheochromocytoma is more significant because it secretes catecholamines, more catecholamine secretion, which will manifest as increased blood pressure, that is systemic hypertension. Okay, but this glomus tumor does not secrete catecholamines of much significance. Okay, in very few cases there is a production of catecholamines. Okay, so it is divided into chromaffin tumor, which is your catecholamine secreting or hormone secreting. A non-chromaffin. There is no hormone secretion. And most of the glomus tumors of middle ear are non-chromaffin, okay? So most Glumashiva middle ear are non-chromaffin. So there is no hormone secretion, so there will be no hypertension. If there is hormone secreting, how we will assess before the surgery, you should measure the urinary vinyl mandelic acid. Okay, so this measurement or assessing this will give you the clue whether it is a chromaffin tumor or non-chromaffin tumor. So glomus jugulare as I told, which arises from the floor of the middle ear. Okay, this is the middle ear. And you could see the sigmoid sinus coming from the posterior to the posterior wall, which then continues as a jugular bulb. Okay. Sigmoid sinus, which then continues as internal jugular vein. So this is the jugular bulb, and anterior to the middle ear, there is internal carotid artery running. Okay. So in between there is a plexus of nerves, namely 9th, the 10th, and the 11th nerves. Okay. So if there is a tumor from this, and it will encroach the middle ear. Okay, through the floor into the middle ear. So in between internal jugular vein and internal carotid artery, there is a crest of bone. Okay, if this crest of bone gets eroded, there is an important sign called Phillips sign that we will see while we are dealing with the investigation part. But for the anatomy, you should remember there is a sigmoid sinus which continues as internal jugular vein, and there is internal carotid artery. Between these two, there are plexus of nerves, and a crest of bone separates the internal jugular vein and internal carotid artery. Okay, so the tumor is in contact with the, if the tumor grows or if the tumor enlarges, it comes in contact with the artery, internal carotid artery. Okay, so as you know, the internal carotid artery it will transmit the pulsations. When the tumor is in contact with, if the tumor comes in contact with the internal carotid artery, it will transmit the pulsations. Okay, so that will clinically manifest as pulsatile tinnitus. Okay, so on examination of the tympanic membrane, this could be seen as a reddish mass coming from the floor. Okay, so this is called as rising sun appearance, or red reflex. Okay, so this is the other picture of tympanic membrane where you could see a reddish mass here. Okay, so rising sun appearance. Or it is also called as red reflex. And another sign on examination is your brown sign, which is also called pulsation sign. So the concept is the tumor which is in contact with the internal carotid artery, okay, transmits a pulsation. So while on changing the pressure by Siegel speculum, using Siegel speculum, I hope you would not have seen, it is a bulb like, there is a bulb which is connected to the otoscope. Okay, Through this bulb, we can change the pressure of the internal through the otoscope of the external artery canal. Okay, so through Spiegel speculum, we could change the pressure. Change in pressure will cause blanching. Blanching. Okay, so this is called the Brown sign or pulsation sign. So when there is increase in pressure, there will be blanching on the tumor. Okay, so this is the Brown sign, which is also called as pulsation sign. Okay, and this rising sun appearance, you should not forget. So how this glomerulus tumor will spread? Okay, so spread, it can be divided into 5 or 6 parts. So first, this glomerulus tumor will fill the middle ear. Fill the middle ear, and it will come through the external auditory canal as a polyp. Okay, so not every polyp is glomerulus tumor, but it should be investigated whether it is glomus or of a normal polyp, normal oral polyp. So the next is, it can spread into labyrinth, petrous spot of temporal bone, and it can spread into mastoids, and then into the jugular foramen. So the cranial nerves coming out through the jugular foramen are 9, 10, 11 cranial nerves. Okay, so it could involve the 9, 10, and 11 cranial nerves and cause the palsies of these cranial nerves. And then this tumor, through the eustachian tube, can extend up to nasopharynx. Then it can extend intracranially into the posterior cranial fossa and middle cranial fossa. Okay, and then distendments, which is very rare, which occurs very rarely because it is a benign tumor, which is for distant mets occasionally. Okay, so if when the tumor fills the middle ear, it comes out through, it ruptures the tympanic membrane and comes to the external auditory canal as a polyp. And if there is secondary infection, it will present as pulsatile otorrhea. Okay, if there is secondary infection, it may present as pulsatile otorrhea, but not every glomerulus tumor will present as polyp. If there is polyp, there will be secondary infection, pulsatile otorrhea. So other clinical features will be, the patient will complain of hearing loss if the tumor is if the tumor grows in size. Okay, if there is more progressive growth, there will be hearing loss. Mostly it might be conductive type. And if it involves the inner ear, there will be sensory neural, associated sensory neural hearing loss. Okay, so there might be conductive plus sensory neural hearing loss. And as I told, pulsatile tinnitus, because if the tumor gets in touch with the internal carotid artery, and the pulsation get transmitted into the tumor. Okay, so that's why there will be pulsatile tinnitus. And pulsatile otorrhea, if there is secondary infection. Okay, so coming to the investigation, and there is also before that, there will be cranial nerve palsies. As I told, the 9, 10, 11 cranial nerves will be most commonly affected, and audible bruit sometimes might be present. Okay, because it is a, if it is in touch with, contact with the internal carotid artery, there might be audible bruit. Okay, so investigations has written the all the tuning fork test to know whether it is conductive or sensory neural hearing loss, the pure tone audiogram. Coming to the tumor, the most common investigation you should do is CT, which is a contrast enhanced CT, okay? Because to know the bone erosion. The tumor arises from the floor of the middle ear and it erodes the bone, okay? So to know the bone erosion, you should do contrast enhanced CT. So this, if the bone erodes in between, as I told, in between the internal jugular vein and the internal carotid artery, it is called as Phelps sign. Okay. There is a crest of bone which gets eroded. So to view this, to know whether the bone is eroded or not, you should do CECT. And other investigations, MRI for to look the soft tissues, and angiography for know whether the vessels are involved. Okay, so these are the other investigations, but this CECT is most important. It should, okay. So before ending, the management. If the tumor is less than 3 cm, and if it is, the patient is asymptomatic, we no need to do any intervention, okay? So just wait and watch. That is of a very close follow-up, okay? So the patient should come for regular follow-up. If the tumor is less than 3 cm, but the patient is symptomatic, the complaints of hearing loss, tinnitus, okay? So then you should go with gamma knife radiotherapy. Gamma knife radiotherapy is nothing but a radio surgery where the tumor alone is. This radiotherapy will slow down the growth of tumor, okay? So do not completely arrest the growth of tumor. If the tumor is less than more than 3 cm, then surgery should be done, okay? Surgery, there are a number of approaches. Before surgery, urinary vinyl mandelic acid and urinary catecholamines should be done to know whether it is chromaffin, because if there is catecholamines, if it is a chromaffin secreting tumor, there might be increase pressure, hypertension during the surgery, okay? So that it will lead to complication, severe complication. So that should be avoided. So you should do urinary vinyl mandelic acid and catecholamines. Urinary catecholamines level should be done. So surgical approaches mostly for smaller tumors, transcanal approach. The hypotympanic approach. They will not ask about the approaches, but you should know the treatment protocols. If it is less than 3 cm or if it is more than 3 cm, okay. So that ends the glomus tumor. Glomus is not of it's very tough to understand, okay. So the only concept you should know is it is a tumor of paraganglioma, okay, and it most commonly arises from the jugular wall, which is the floor of the middle ear, and the rising sun appearance and the brown sign, okay, and in CECT that is Phelps sign. So these signs are important in the MCQ perspectives for PG or for PG entrance examination. For pre-final years, you should know the clinical features, complaints, and the investigations and the treatment part, okay. So the next tumor is it is a tumor of the inner ear, or you can say it is as a tumor of cerebellopontine angle. So that is acoustic neuroma, which is otherwise called as Vestibular schwannoma. So this is also a benign tumor, like glomus. It is benign, locally invasive. Okay, so and it affects most commonly the elderly. Elderly individuals. If it occurs in young patients, it is usually associated with neurofibromatosis 2. Okay, if it is associated with neurofibromatosis 2, there will be bilateral acoustic neuroma in both sides. Okay, so this is usually benign, locally invasive, and it is an unilateral tumor. It won't. If it is associated with neurofibromatosis 2 condition, there will be a bilateral acoustic neuroma. Okay. So acoustic neuroma, this is also called vestibular schwannoma. The origin is from inferior vestibular nerve. So I hope you remember the anatomy, how the nerves exit the facial nerve and vestibular cochlear nerve. So this is the internal acoustic meatus. Okay, this is Bill's burr, which separates, which is in the superficial part of the internal acoustic meatus, which separates the facial nerve and superior vestibular nerve. Here will be cochlear nerve and inferior vestibular nerve. So this acoustic neuroma is a tumor of inferior vestibular nerve, which arises from inferior vestibular nerve, okay, in the internal acoustic meatus. So you could see here, this is the petrous part of temporal bone. It is the internal acoustic meatus and the tumor coming from. So okay, so this is the brainstem and this is the cerebellum. So midbrain, pons, and which continues at cerebellum. So this tumor is not arising from the cerebellopentine angle. It arises from the internal acoustic meatus and it goes into the cerebellopontine angle. Okay, so that's why it is called as tumor of cerebellopontine angle. You should not confuse that it does not arise from cerebellopontine angle. Okay, so this is the internal acoustic meatus, you could see. The 8th nerve and 7th nerve. So from here, this is the cerebellum. This is the part where the cerebellum rests, and this the brainstem comes like this. Okay, so this angle, so this angle is your cerebellopontine angle. The tumor comes like this, encroaches the cerebellopontine angle. Okay. So this is the petrous part of temporal bone, and you could see here there is foramen ovale, and here there is foramen spinosum. You could see other cranial nerves exiting the base of the skull. Okay, so this is why this is important, because when the tumor grows, it encroaches the adjacent structures, and it encroaches the adjacent foramen. Here there is jugular foramen. Okay. So it encroaches the adjacent structure, so that the adjacent nerves which exit through this part of skull will also get involved. Okay, so we will come into that detail now. So the clinical features is based on the tumor encroaching. Okay, so the earliest, so you could see here the tumor. From here, it will enlarge. So this cochlear nerve, or the cochlear part of vestibular cochlear nerve, is the first to involve. Okay, get involved, and then it further it extends. Sorry. So we'll draw once again. The Bell's bar. We have the facial nerve, superior vestibular, cochlear nerve, internal crossing meatus, and the inferior vestibular. Okay. So the clinical features or the symptomatology is based on the tumor, how the tumor encroaches, okay, within the internal acoustic meatus, and then how it goes outside. So clinical features in the internal acoustic meatus, okay, first is when it compresses cochlear nerve. So what will happen when it compresses cochlear nerve? Yes, sensory neural hearing loss. Okay, cochlea is a organ of hearing. So if it gets involved, there will be sensory neural hearing loss, and there will be tinnitus. So cochlear nerve is the earliest to get involved. Get involved in acoustic neuroma. Okay, next is superior vestibular nerve. Superior vestibular nerve, which we saw above the inferior vestibular nerve in the internal acoustic meatus. If there is superior vestibular nerve, the vestibular nerve is a nerve of balance, okay, because it takes the sensation from the vestibule, but there won't be any vertigo, because even if there is one side of vestibular nerve is involved or affected, the other side compensates, okay. So there is not much of no clinical significance. Vertigo may be present, but there might, in most of the cases, there won't be vertigo, because the opposite side, the other side of the labyrinth, will take over. So there will be compensatory equilibrium will occur. The next is when the facial nerve compression get compressed. Okay, so facial nerve has sensory part and motor part. It is a mixture now. Okay, so this motor part is more resistant to compression. Sensory part will get compressed, but how to check the sensory component of the facial nerve? The sensory component of the facial nerve supplies the posterior superior area of external acoustic meatus or external auditory canal. Okay, so this the exact posterior superior part of the external auditory canal cannot be tested, because the adjacent area is supplied by your Arnold's nerve, which is a branch of vagus nerve. Okay, so this posterior superior area of external acoustic meatus can be checked, but most of the cases you cannot check the particular exact area. Okay, so if this is affected, there will be hypoesthesia, so there will be decreased sensation of this part. Okay, so it can be checked by pricking that area. So this will be present in only less than 25% of the patients. Okay, so this is in the internal acoustic meatus. Then the tumor grows into the cerebellopontine angle. So what will happen in the cerebellopontine angle if the tumor encroaches the cerebellopontine angle? So the upper pole of the tumor will encroach the fifth nerve. Okay, fifth nerve is the trigeminal nerve. It's mostly a sensory nerve. And sixth nerve. Sixth nerve, it is very easy, because it has only one function. It supplies the extraocular muscles. Okay, so there will be diplopia. If in fifth nerve, it can be tested by corneal reflex. Okay, so if the fifth nerve gets affected, there will be loss of corneal reflex. So corneal reflex, afferent is 5th and efferent is 7th. corneal reflex gets affected when the upper when the tumor of, upper pole of the tumor encroaches. Okay, so if this is affected when the tumor is grows more than 2.5 centimeter, so this corneal reflex is the earliest ocular sign in acoustic neuroma. And the lower pole of the tumor will encroach the jugular foramen. So the jugular foramen, through the jugular foramen, the 9th, 10th, 11th cranial nerves will pass. So and it will result in palsies of these three cranial nerves. Okay. So the most common or earliest nerve to be involved, earliest cranial nerve is 8th. Which is followed by 7th nerve, but 7th nerve cannot be elicited. Okay, you cannot, as I told, because of the mixed innervation of that part, the 7th nerve involvement cannot be more accurately elicited. So, 5th nerve followed, 8th nerve followed by 5th nerve is most common or the earliest. This like this way the cranial nerve involvement goes. Okay, so first 8th, then 7th. Due to the inaccurate elicitation, you can say this 5th nerve is the next affected. Okay. By loss of corneal reflex. So this is the clinical features. So coming to the diagnosis or investigation, okay, the investigation part, we'll start with tuning fork test. As usual, Rinne's will be okay. Weber's will go to opposite side. Weber's will get lateralized to better ear, okay, in sensorineural hearing loss, and conduct neural hearing loss to the same side. Airborne conduction will be reduced. Swabaks will be reduced. And pure tone audiogram will show sensorineural hearing loss, and there will be no airborne gap, okay. Airborne gap is seen in conductive hearing loss, and stapedial reflex, the striking feature is stapedial reflex will be present, but there will be decay of stapedial reflex. That is, the stapedial reflex will be present when you keep on eliciting, but when you go on eliciting the stapedial reflex, it will fail to respond. That is, it will the fatigue, there will be fatigue, okay, so that is called as decay of stapedial reflex. And best audiometric test for acoustic neuroma is Bera, that I told you already when we are seeing about the audiology part, not acoustic emission and Bera. Okay, so I won't go into further detail again. If you miss that, you can go and see that. Okay, so Bera is brainstem evoked response audiometry. It is the best audiometric test for acoustic neuroma. Okay, so what will be the findings in the Bera? So there will be interaural latency of 5th nerve, okay, or 5th wave. So Bera will Bera is the how you see the waves of the auditory pathway, right? Okay, from the vestibular cochlear nerve into the cochlear nucleus, then your superior olivary complex, lateral meniscus, and it goes to the medial geniculate body and auditory cortex. Okay, so each part there is each wave from 1 to 5. Okay, so there will be interaural latency of 5th wave. Okay. Which will be more than 0.2, only 0.2. Interaural latency means interaural between 2 years. Okay, so for this year and for the another or better year. Okay, so the affected year, there will be the 5th wave will appear late. That is the interaural latency. Okay, so and latency between wave 1 and wave 5 will increase. Okay, so this is the audiometric test, and the best overall best investigation is MRI with gadolinium enhancement. Okay, is the overall best investigation for acoustic neuroma. So this will show ice cream cone appearance. That you should not forget. Okay, so in the cerebellopontian angle, the tumor when viewed by gadolinium contrast, there will be a typical appearance of ice cream cone appearance. So coming to treatment part, it goes like the same way as gliomas. Okay, if the tumor is less than 3 cm, it is very slow growing compared to glomus tumor. So if it's less than 3 cm and asymptomatic, wait and watch. That is, the patient should come for a regular follow-up. More than 3 cm, less than 3 cm and asymptomatic, less than 3 cm and symptomatic, you should go for gamma radiotherapy. And more than 3 cm, as usual, surgical excision. Okay. Surgical excision is through middle cranial fossa approach, translabyrinthine, so they will not ask the approaches in detail, but you should know the names of the approaches. Okay, translabyrinthine, then is retrosigmoid approach. Okay, if this two is done simultaneously, then it is the combined translabyrinthine and retrosigmoid approach. So these are the various approaches for excision of the acoustic neuroma. Okay, so coming to the histopathology, this is very important. Okay, Antony type A, Antony B, this is same for all the schwannomas. Okay, this is also called as vestibular schwannoma. Every schwannoma, there will be this Antony type A and an Antony type B. Okay, so type A means you could see the tumor cells arranged in a compact arrangement. Here there will be loose arrangement, and there will be, you could see the cystic spaces here. Okay, with cystic spaces. Okay, so if in young patients, there may be associated condition neurofibromatosis, where there will be bilateral acoustic neuroma. Okay, so in bilateral acoustic neuroma, the hearing will be gone after the surgery, so the rehabilitation is done through auditory brainstem implant. Okay, that you will see in a few minutes. This is done in young patients where there is bilateral acoustic neuroma. Okay, so now coming to hearing rehabilitation. Hearing rehabilitation will be seeing bone anchored hearing aids, cochlear implants. I'm dealing with only the most important topic for your exams, for both pre-finals and for entrance exams. Okay, auditory brainstem implant. There are many, but due to lack of time, only I will cover these three. So BAH is also called as bone anchored hearing aid. Okay, so this bone anchored hearing aid, you could see here the implant is fitted in the post auricular region, or in the mastoid part of the temporal bone. Okay, so this is indication for BAH is deformed pinna, where there is the pinna and external auditory canal has not developed or not formed, this bone anchored hearing aid can be a good alternative. Deformed pinna or external auditory canal in chronically discharging ear, because of the electric device, if there is chronic discharging of pus or any moisture, the device will not work. Okay, so any chronically discharging ear and there is hearing aid and there is hearing loss, we can advise this hearing aid. And in post-cholesteatoma or post-unsafe CSOM, where modified radical mastectomy is done. So post-modified radical mastectomy, where there is a big cavity, okay? You cannot fit other hearing aids. And in single-sided deafness. So what is this bone anchored hearing aid? This BAHA will replace, or it will take over the function of external auditory canal, pinna and middle ear. Okay, so once you fit the bone anchored hearing aid, it will directly stimulate the inner ear. Okay, so it will take over the function of these three: external auditory canal, pinna and middle ear. Okay, so this is how the external bone anchored hearing aids are kept. So this is the parts of the bone anchored hearing aid. You could see the titanium implant. There is an abutment and there is a sound processor which is fit in the external side of the mastoid part of the temporal bone. Okay, so the concept is, there is this through this titanium screw, there is osseo integration. Okay, so this could be done only when there is skull thickness should be more than 3 millimeter. Okay, so it cannot be done in very young infants. So the according to FDA, okay, there is US FDA, the minimum age is 5 years, but coming to Indian protocols or worldwide, it can be done as soon as, this according to US FDA, but as soon as 3 years of age, it can be done. Okay, so this is the normal hearing aid or the normal ear, but bone anchored hearing aid cannot be fitted when there is if there is a deformity of the external auditory canal pinna, this conventional hearing aids cannot be fitted. Okay, so you could see here, this is the deformed pinna or a malformed pinna. Okay, this is the microosseous, so you could see the hearing aid here. Okay, so what is the concept is, this bone anchored hearing aid, through this abutment and into the titanium screw, this will vibrate the skull. Okay, and you could see the vibration goes into the inner ear. Okay, it then vibrates the labyrinth and through then the hearing takes place. Okay, so the components will be, don't forget the components, a titanium screw through which there is also integration and abutment and speech processor. So the next is cochlear implant. Cochlear implant is most commonly done for very young child with born sensory neural hearing loss, okay, with congenital sensory neural hearing loss. So the ideology of cochlear implant is, it replaces organ of Corti. Okay, so if there is organ of Corti is deformed, or if there is any pathology there, we can go for cochlear implant, but the provided cochlear nerve or the retrocochlear pathway should be intact. Okay, so cochlear nerve should be present. So this is the prerequisite of cochlear implant. Okay, only the it replaces only the organ of Corti. So okay, so this is the parts of the cochlear implant. This is the conventional normal hearing aid. There is a speech processor, microphone, and these are the electrodes. Okay, and there is a transmitter coil. So we will see that now. So this is the outline, or this is the parts of the cochlear implant. So the ideology is the external speech processor, which is fitted outside. Okay, that will receive the sound, and the processor sends digital signals, which converts the sound to digital signals. Okay, and the internal implant that turns the signals into electrical energy, which sends it through the electrodes into the cochlea. Okay, bypassing the damaged hair cells. Okay, so this is the principle of cochlear implant. You could see here the speech processor, the receiver of stimulator, which is then fitted through the round window into the scalar tympani. Okay, so coming to the indications, it can be done for severe to profound hearing loss. Okay, so severe means 70 decibel, profound means more than 90 decibels hearing loss. Okay, and if the child does not gets any benefit with conventional hearing aid. Conventional hearing aid, okay. Hearing aid for at least 3 months. And it can be done for any age group. Okay, so for prelingual deafness, prelingual means the child born deaf. Okay, so the child has not yet started speaking. That is called as prelingual deafness. For prelingual deafness, it is done as soon as possible. That is 1 year. From 1 year of age, it is done. Okay, this surgery is done. And the prerequisites, as I told, cochlear nerve should be functional, and central auditory pathways. Should be intact. Cochlea should be present. Okay, and the child has to be mentally and physically stable to further for hearing aid details and for further speech therapy. Okay, so the child should be mentally and physically stable. So coming to the components, so microphone, which picks sound, picks sounds from the external environment, speech processor that converts sound to digital signals, and transmitter coil. It sends sound into the electrodes inside. Okay, so these three are external components. So from the transmitter coil, there is a receiver coil. Okay, from this receiver coil, there is through the stimulator, it stimulates the electrodes, which is placed in scalar tympani. Okay, electrodes are placed in scalar tympani through, I hope you remember, through round window. Okay, so by the facial recess approach, I told you during anatomy, through facial recess approach, the electrodes are passed into the round window into the scala tympani. So these are internal components. Okay, so that is your cochlear implant, and the last is auditory brainstem implant. Okay, so this auditory brainstem implant, I already told you, it is placed in the lateral recess of fourth ventricle. This auditory brainstem, this cochlear implant, it will replace the organ of Corti. Okay, when the hair cells get damaged, this auditory brainstem implant, it will replace cochlear nerve. So the retrocochlear pathway, when that gets involved, or when that gets, when the pathology is there, it will, this auditory brainstem implant is useful. Okay, it replaces cochlear nerve. It is usually done in neurofibromatosis 2 post-op patients in absent cochlea. So you could see here, this is the auditory brainstem implant. The electrodes are placed directly in the brainstem. Okay, so this was, I think this was asked a few years back in NEET. So for pre-finals, you should know the difference between these three implants. Okay, so last two topics are very short topics, which can be asked just a short notes. Okay, for pre-finals. So that is sudden sensory neural hearing loss. I will finish it within a matter of 3 to 5 minutes. Okay. So sudden sensory neural hearing loss. This is an important short notes for both pre-finals and for PG entrance exam also. So what is sudden sensory neural hearing loss? It is a hearing loss that occurs within 3 days. Okay. Hearing loss should be within 3 days. More than 30 decibels hearing loss in three consecutive frequencies. It's so there may be 500, 1000, 2000, or 1000, 2000, 4000. So like that in three consecutive frequencies. Okay. So this is sudden sensory neural hearing loss. So etiology might be idiopathic, any infections. Okay, so infections like viral infections are most common. So mumps, herpes zoster, then meningitis, and syphilis. Okay, so trauma, any head injury, vascular, so any hemorrhage or ischemia. Meniere's disease, ototoxicity. So in these conditions, there will be sudden sensory neural hearing loss. Okay, sudden sensory neural hearing loss. So, but the term, it is sudden within a matter of 3 days. And only the sensory neural component is affected. Okay, so what will be the tuning fork test? Renis will be positive. Okay, so that is Renis positive means normal hearing, or it might be sensory neural hearing loss. So Weber's, it will lateralize to opposite side, and PTA will show sensory neural hearing loss. Okay, so what if there is severe sensory neural hearing loss? So severe sensory neural hearing loss, if this sudden sensory neural hearing loss is not addressed as early, it will lead to severe sensory neural hearing loss. Okay, so in this severe sensory neural hearing loss, the Renis will be negative. I hope you remember when we are seeing about the audiology. So if Renis is negative, two conditions should come to your mind: conductive hearing loss or severe sensory neural hearing loss. Okay, not sudden but severe. And Weber's will be as usual for like since in hearing loss, it will be lateral is to opposite side. Okay, so with this, so with if it is a conductive hearing loss, vibers will be of to the same side. Okay, so through this you can differentiate whether it is sensorineural or conductive. Okay, so coming to treatment of sudden sensorineural hearing loss. Sudden sensorineural hearing loss. Okay, so what will you give is high dose steroids. High dose steroids to reduce the edema. Okay, if there is any edema, through this, through which there could be ischemia. So high dose steroids in a dose of 1 mg/kg body weight. It should be given for 5 days. If there is no response, you should give transtympanic steroid injection through a microwick. Okay, we saw while discussing about meningotomy, grommet insertion. Okay, so transtympanic steroid injections, which is given through round window. Okay. So, and most common etiology being viral, so antiviral should be given. Vasodilators,